We got together with Pastor Chris and Pastor Stephen on Thursday to just go in after the presence of God and try to pen lyric and melody. And after a couple of hours, it just felt like the presence of God just stopped everything. And we wrote a song called The Blessing. And it's straight from Scripture. And it's the heart of the Father over us as His kids. And we're going to sing it this morning, if that's okay. And this is a blessing over you and your family and your children. So just receive this morning. Just put your hands out in front of you. Turn your heart to a place of just receiving the blessing of heaven from God Himself over you this morning.
Children, may His favor be upon you and a thousand. presence go before, behind, beside, all around you, within you. He is in, He is in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going. You're rejoiced. He is for.
He is for.
May the favor. May the favor.
Be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. Be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children.
Praise the Lord, Lighthouse of the Valley family, and to all of our viewers around the world. We're so glad that you have chosen this Sunday to be with us. And to all of our fathers out there, our surrogate fathers, our stepfathers, our grandfathers, our spiritual fathers, and fathers that are young, that are going to be future fathers, we welcome you, and we want to say Happy Father's Day to all of you. So somebody take time right now and just tell somebody around you Happy Father's Day. Take a moment, congratulate them. Some of you need to feed them dinner after all this is over, but we're so glad that you decided to be with us on this Father's Day. We're hoping that you'll enjoy the service, but more importantly, that you'll draw closer to the Father of all fathers, the greatest Father that there ever was and ever will be. We're talking about our Heavenly Father. We're talking about Jesus Christ. We're so thankful that you're here today. So let's just worship. Let's just honor God. We want to welcome Lighthouse of the Bay, Lighthouse of India, Lighthouse of Liberia, Lighthouse Spanish. We want to welcome the Lighthouse of what is it we got here? Of Maui, Lighthouse of Windsor. We want to welcome all of you, even the pastors over there in Uganda that are new friends. We want to welcome all of you and hope that you have a great time and enjoy everything. God bless you. Let's go with the singers and allow them just to have their way in here, and let's just worship God before we get into the message, in Jesus' name.
Come on, put those hands together. Let's worship the Lord.
Yeah. afraid to worship him right now. Come on, don't be afraid to praise him right now. Come on, relinquish that praise. Come on, relinquish that worship. Whoa, let's feel his throne room right now. Let's feel his throne room right now. Whoa, worship him, Jesus. Come on. Come on, get a praise on your lip right now.
Lift up your hands and say,
chains are broken.
Here I am.
All right, come on, let's put our hands together. How many believe that miracles are in the house? How many believe that God can do anything? God is in this place right now. On this Father's Day, the Lord is doing a great work, and some of you need to lift up your hands, do a little shout, run around the house, whatever it is you do, and allow God to just take control in the atmosphere right now. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. If you have your Bibles, let's go on and break them out, because the Lord has a word for our men, for our ladies, for our young people, everyone that's gathering. We want to say again to the fathers, we're so glad you're here, future fathers and surrogate fathers, spiritual fathers, fathers to be, whomever you may be, we're just so glad you're here. And ladies, we know that some of you are standing in the gap, as fathers shouldn't have to do that. But, you know, it is what it is, as some of them say. And we're just glad that all of us are in the house of the Lord right now. So get your Bibles out. We're going to be going to John chapter 14, a very familiar passage of scripture to some of you and to others. This may be the first time that you're hearing a message like this on a Father's Day. And we want you to not only enjoy it, but take part, and hopefully there's a transformation that's going to take place in our fathers here today. Hopefully we're going to produce some greater men that will walk out of here. And I know we're going to be focusing a lot on talking to men, but ladies, it's good for you to hear this, because when you hear this, you know what to expect, or you know what should be happening in your area of influence in your household, or if you're looking for a guy one day to settle down in your house. Give you some good tools today. John chapter 14, I'll be reading verses 2 and 3. Jesus said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." He says, "I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." Today I want to talk to us about a good father. Somebody say it with me. A good father. That's what we're after today. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you and we honor you for being able to gather again in a place like this. Lord, we might be locked down, but we're not locked out of heaven. I thank you for the fathers that have gathered in here, Lord God, and the surrogate fathers and the stepfathers and all the fathers that are spiritually in tune with what I'm talking about and helping young men and women to be all they can be. I thank you for those that stand in the gap of that fatherhood place and they're helping to raise children or take care of households. I pray in Jesus' name that you will open our eyes and let our ears be attentive. Allow me to preach, teach, and whatever you would want me to do to help this group and these people all around, no matter where they're at, whether in the United States or outside in another country, wherever they're gathering, Lord, in a house, in a school, they could be on their jobs, they can be anywhere, they could be homeless, and they're still watching this. I pray in Jesus' name that the anointing would be on them, and Lord, we would glean, and the power of God would enable us, Lord, to be good fathers in Jesus' name. Can you say in Jesus' name? One more time, go ahead and put your hands together for the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Good fathers. Now, let me just say and ratify what I'm trying to say here. I am not trying to say one thing, and I'm going to articulate that, but to the fathers and to the father figures, the surrogate fathers, the spiritual fathers, the ones who stand in fathership roles, I am not saying that we should be expected to be the best fathers or the greatest fathers or the most prominent fathers. But really, what I'm saying is we need to learn how to be good fathers. Everybody say good fathers. This is what we have a dearth of good fathers. And sometimes it's at the expense because we're trying to be so great, or we're trying to be so prominent, or we just want to be able to be known so others will look at us some great thing. And if I can't obtain greatness, I just give up on it altogether. That's not what we should be doing. But I'm trying to say we need to be good fathers. That's it. Say, you need to say that in your mind, say that in your heart, and believe that. See, because when you learn that it's not about being the best or it's not about being the greatest, even the Lord said, they that compare themselves among themselves are not wise. So don't do that. In other words, you'll never be a father like me and I'll never be a father like you. Even your own father, you're not going to be just like him. You're not even going to be like your Heavenly Father. But there are some things that we can glean from one another and from our Heavenly Father that will help us to be good fathers. And let's talk about that. A good father, number one, makes provision for his household. A good father understands that he is to make provision for his household. Now notice what our scripture text says. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many dwellings or many mansions. I go, and I'm jumping ahead a little bit. He says, I go to prepare a place for you. He's telling his disciples there, I'm going to prepare a place for you because in my Father's house, there's all these dwelling places. Something we need to understand is that as a father, a good father will provide for his household. And you think, well, man, I have to give my kids everything, or I have to give them what the neighbors are giving them. I got to have the same car. I've got to have the same kind of house and all these kind of things. You're missing it all together. God is not looking for you to keep up with the Joneses, but he's looking for you to be a good father that provides. In other words, your provision for your family may pale in comparison to my provision for my family. It may be that you may not have some of the other things that someone else has. I may not be able to give all my kids the education or other things that other people were able to afford based upon their economical and their sociological, whatever plight they may be in or whatever stance they have. I may not be able to do that, but I can make provision. You may be homeless today, but yet as a father, you still have the responsibility of providing for your household. You may not be able to give them 3 square meals a day, but you can give them something. And the only way you're going to do that is to get in the presence of God and say, Lord, you have told me to provide, but I recognize, God, that you are Jehovah Jireh, the God that provides. And you're the provider. I'm not provided by the church or provided by the welfare system or anyone else. I'm provided by you. And Lord, provide for me that I can provide for my household. See, the scripture tells us, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things that you need provision for, all these things that you have need of, shall be added unto you. They'll be added unto you. I'm talking to some men right now that they get a revelation, get an understanding, get an illumination, and get some backbone and stand up and get on your knees and say, Lord, this is my house. See, some of you will go on that football field and say, this is my house. This is my house. You know, and I've seen that. My kids play Pop Warner too. And you're so excited about your kids playing and being the running back or wide receiver, the quarterback, whatever they are. And you're just shaking and rocking everything. But what about providing and saying, this is my house? Being like Joshua, who said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. See, be that covering. Be that provider that understands that God is my supplier and he'll provide me everything I need. God will give me everything I need according to his riches in glory. And if I understand that, then I can reassure my household that God's going to provide. Now, God does have a plan. In other words, bring all the tithe into the storehouse. It doesn't matter if you have a dollar, give 10 cents. If you've got $10,000, give $1,000. Why? Because the principle remains the same. This is God's financial plan, but this financial plan works whether you're up or whether you're down. It works across the board, and it is the man. It is the father. A good father understands I've got to provide, but my provider is God, who gives me everything I have need of that I might provide for my household when I obey his principles. That's some good stuff. The Apostle Paul told his son in the gospel, talking about Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 8, he says this, but if any provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he hath denied the faith and is worse. He didn't put you on the same line. He said he's worse than an infidel, an unbeliever. He didn't line you up with a backslidden person in the church. He didn't put you in with the lukewarm. He put you in there with people that don't even know God. He said, if you are not providing for your household, And again, let me reaffirm this and let me drag this in deeper. It's not that you're able to give them everything you want to give them or everything they feel they deserve, but you're making provision. It may not be everything that they need in its fullness, but yet you have given yourself to God and said, God, what do you want me? I'm doing my best. That's all he asks you to do, to be a good father. Not just shirking your duties and saying, you know what, why don't you go to the welfare system? Or why don't you have your mama take care of you? Or why don't you have the church take care of you? Or why don't you have your brother take care of you? No. It's your responsibility, because a good man, a good father, makes provision for his household. King Solomon said this in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 22. A good man, and let me put in there good father, okay, since we're on this subject. A good father leaveth an inheritance to his children's children. In other words, the work that you're doing and the things you're accumulating and things you're putting together, it's not just so you can enjoy it all and eat everything up, that there's nothing left over. But you leave an inheritance for your children's children. In other words, your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren, your posterity, understanding that the Lord can bless you if he can trust you. And if he can trust you, he'll put stuff in you so that you'll be able to be that conduit, not only to give to others, but first to take care of your household. See, a good man, a good father understands this, that the way that I live now, the way that I invest now, the things that I do now, I'm looking ahead, the houses that I build and whatever I do, I'm not doing it for me and mama. I'm doing it for my children's children. A good father. Number two, a good father does not withhold the truth from his household. See, no secrets. Does not withhold the truth from his household. Notice Jesus continues to say in verse 2, in my Father's house are many mansions, okay, dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. In other words, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm going to tell you the truth. He goes on to say, I go to prepare a place for you. Now notice the verbiage here. He says, I go to prepare a place for you. That means I've got to die. Now they may not have got it right there, but what's what he's saying? I gotta die to get where I'm going to give you what I need. I'm not gonna lie to you. I gotta die to get it, to get you in this mansion and to prepare the place that I wanna prepare for you and to get ready for you to come. I've gotta die. I've gotta go through some things. See, Jesus told his disciples or his followers the truth, even though it hurt. See, sometimes telling your children or your household the truth, it may hurt. And you may try and shield them and not allow them to go through pain. And I know moms are like this a lot. And we don't want to let our kids go through pain. But pain has a way of sometimes teaching you things. The scripture says, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials. These testings, they bring out the best in you. The trial of your faith worketh patience. Let patience have her perfect work in you. In other words, let it produce what it's trying to produce. And the Lord was telling his disciples, I've got to go and I'm going to prepare a place for you. But you got to understand something. I'm going to die to do it. And it's going to hurt you. When Jesus, Mary was going to have Jesus, the prophet looked at her and said, your heart's going to be pierced. Talking about his death and what she had to go through and what she had to experience as a mom. And let me say this, dads, we don't conceal the truth from our children. We let our children understand. We let our household understand that some things are going to be rough. If you're going through a hard time right now, it's not like you're trying to act like it's not hard and act like, you know, just living in this with your head in the sand and denial and not owning up to the truth, but being very honest and say, here's where we're at, family. Here's where we're at. And you start laying out a plan. And you don't, maybe if you don't even know what the plan is, I'm seeking God and I'm going to get before God. I don't know. Pray for me. But you tell them the truth, even though it hurts. I've lost my job. It may hurt. I've lost my position or things in life that I thought were dear to me. We got repossessed here. We lost our home. Whatever. Even though it hurts. We've got to go to a homeless shelter, even though it hurts. Life is tough, son or daughter. It's not always going to be. When you give your life to Jesus Christ, you tell your kids, oh, everything's going to be all right. Oh, you're just going to have it. The tiger by the tail. No, don't lie to them. Yeah, the end result is you're going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ forever and ever and ever. But in this life, you're going to have tribulation. You're going to have trouble. You're going to be persecuted. You're going to be rejected. You're going to be hated by all men on this earth. This is what the scripture tells you. And fathers, we need to prepare our children for what is to come. We don't lie to them. We don't tell them a lie. We don't get them to buy into a lie just so that we can see that they'll conform to Jesus Christ. No, we tell them the truth. You're a warrior. You're a soldier. You've been drafted. God has plans for you, but those plans are going to cost you. Jesus was saying, pain that I'm going to endure is going to be gain. This pain that I've got to go through and that you've got to go through is going to produce something that is beneficial to everybody. Amen? And number three is a big one. A good father does not abandon his household. A good father does not abandon his household. He does not desert his post. He doesn't throw in the towel. He doesn't say, that's it. It's over. I'm done. I'm gone. I'm not in this anymore. And just leave. Just walk away. A good father doesn't say, you know, that's all. I'm done. You know, you do whatever you got to do. Do what you got to do. And just go on and give your kids, your family over to the enemy. Except the enemy bind the strong man in that house. He can't take that family. And you're the strong man, Dad. I'm talking to you fathers now. I'm coming right down your lane. We're in the 21st century and all fathers of the earth need to hear what Pastor is saying right now. The enemy wants to come in like a flood. The Lord can raise up the standard, but he needs a man that's going to stand in the gap. He needs a father that's going to say, not here, not there. I'm drawing a line in the sand. You can't cross it. Unless he bind that strong man, he cannot take that house. But if he bind the strong man, shackle you up and tie you up and tear you down to the point where you give in, then he can spoil your whole house. This is what we're trying to guard against. Men, never abandon your household. A good father does not, he refuses. He does not abandon his household. He doesn't say that it's not worth it because it is. Let me just give you a statistic. There's a crisis in the United States of America, and it's affecting all of us that I'm talking to right now. In America, 19.7 million households do not have a father figure present in the house. 19.7 million. That's one out of every four households have no father in the house. And in some communities, 75%, oh my goodness, 75% of the households in those communities do not have a father figure in the household. That's a travesty. Now, let me say this in saying that, that's not the government's fault. That's not the other generation that we just came out, their fault. It's not a policy. It's not because of economics. It's not because we just can't get along. It's the father's fault. Now, let me bring this down to where we're living right now and speak to these men and some that are listening to me right now. If you have a household and you've been through divorce or you've just left or whatever, I don't know what your circumstances are. And with some of those things cannot be repaired. So that's not what I'm trying to do. You can call Dr. Phil about that. But what I'm trying to tell you to do is to understand your responsibility as a dad, as a father, and you are not to abandon that household. Now, the wife that you left and now you're married to someone else and all that, she's not your responsibility, but those children are. And you say, no, that's her and her new husband. No, they're yours. And this little smidgen of stuff and crumbs that you throw to them and every once in a while pop up and all that kind of stuff, that's not going to do. God is saying, those are your children, your household. And when you abandon them and turn them over to some other system, That system will raise them, the streets will raise them, or some other type of warped mentality may raise them. They grow up, many of them, with no father figure at all. And hopefully some surrogate father, some spiritual father in the church gets a burden for them. But many times it goes undone and they grow up fatherlessness. So when it comes time to communicate with the Father of all fathers, they're having a hard time with it because of us. A good father never abandons his household. He goes back for them. And you got to understand something. I'm talking to myself as well as to every man that's listening. Ladies, you just watch and listen, because I'm talking to the men. You may not be able to repair some relationships that have been broken, but about these kids, you've got to do everything in your power. And I want to say, now I do want to address the ladies. Ladies, if you're married to a man that has been divorced or has been estranged or is totally done with his former life and woman that he had in that life and everything, and they had children out of that relationship, you should be the champion to make sure those children and that man that's your husband or your boyfriend or whatever he is now, that man and those children have a good relationship. You should foster that relationship so it can be restored to what it needs to be. I thank God for my stepmother, because she put in the effort to make sure the relationship between my father and I would thrive when she came on the scene. My father and I, you know, we as I came into my teens and into my adulthood, we had been estranged for a while, but she got in there and she made sure that we connected. And my father was so gracious that he just jumped on board and he became like my best friend. And I was able to mend some of those places in my life because my father was in my life, but it took a woman like my stepmom, Julie, to come into my life, to come into my dad's life, and to encourage him to have a good relationship with his son and with his daughter. A good father doesn't abandon his household. I do understand, and trust me, I understand about divorce better than most. And the thing about it is, when you go through that, you don't divorce the children. It's better that you never divorce, and it is better that God would want it so you have one man, one woman for a lifetime. But stuff happens, and when it does, it doesn't mean that you relinquish all your rights and say, well, you know, just raise the kids, go to your mom's house, go to your grandmom's house, go. And then you have all these testimonies about children being raised by their grandmother and grandfather, and children living at auntie so-and-so's house and uncle's house, rather than the father stepping in there and saying, this is not the way I wanted it to be, but these are my children and I will not abandon them. Even if you don't have much, what you have, you share, you do, you provide, because they're your children. A good father. You didn't know if it was going to go there, huh? A good father does not abandon ship. A good father goes down with his crew, gathers them and say, this is not what I expected and what I wanted, but this is what we have. Let's make it work. Let's swim to shore. We'll do it together. And guess what will happen? Those children will grow up knowing that, man, I wish we wouldn't have ended up like this, but you know, there's something about my father. We're not talking to ladies right now, but there's something about my father. He's a good man. He's a good father. He did his best. He was just trying to help provide for me, cover me. He realized he wasn't going to lie to me and just act like, oh, I couldn't come see you because of the wonderful things he does. No, he got in there and he did his best. A good father has a way of instilling hope and comfort. A good father, when he realizes his responsibilities and he's willing to tell the truth and be truthful with himself and those around him, he is able to instill, he emanates with this, he inspires hope and comfort. in the latter part of this chapter 14 and verse 18, Jesus says this, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. He says, "No, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you." Wow. Jesus is saying, I've got to go, and I'm going through death, and I'm going up into heaven. He said, but I'm coming back. I will not leave you as orphans. I will not leave you comfortless. The King James says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. I'm coming back for you. Son, I'm gone, and things didn't work out between me and your mom, but I'm not leaving you. Daughter, I'm not leaving you. I will not leave you as orphans. I won't let the state raise you. I won't let the church raise you. I won't let teachers raise you. I won't let the streets raise you. I will raise you. I'll do my best. I'll put in, I'll do some elbow grease. I'll work two or three jobs, whatever I have to do to help you be who you are supposed to be. Why? Because I'm just a good father. That's what I want to be. I want to be known as a good father. Hopefully some of you, the epitaph on your tombstone would read, "There was a good father, good man." Not the best, not the greatest, not the most flamboyant, didn't have everything, lacked a lot, but he was a good father. I want to make a pledge, and I'd like to lead in this pledge with all of our fathers, future fathers, wannabe fathers, fathers that can't be fathers, but they'll be spiritual fathers. I'd like you to repeat this pledge with me today on Father's Day. And ladies, I would like for you to help keep them accountable, but don't be so hard on them when they fall short, when we fall short. But fathers, if you will, repeat after me. Future fathers, spiritual fathers, fathers that are going to stand in the gap, repeat after me. I pledge to cultivate a godly atmosphere in my home. Number two, I pledge to lead and serve my wife and my children. Number three, I pledge to take time to cultivate a friendship between me and my family. Number four, I pledge to not to be too busy when my family needs me. Number five, I pledge to love my wife and children unconditionally. Number six, I pledge to compliment my wife for her dedication to our family. I pledge to introduce my children to Jesus Christ and to model Christ-likeness to them. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I thank you for the men in particular, the young men that have joined us on this Father's Day. I pray for their souls, Lord Jesus, that they would be touched in a mighty way. That, Lord, as they walk away from this experience with you, that they'll walk away different men, that they'll grow, many of them, into good men, good fathers. And I pray for fathers that are here today watching and listening, grandfathers, those, Lord God, that have fallen short, that they would not condemn themselves, but they would go right from where they're at. Take it from today. Today is a new day. I pray for women that have had to stand in the gap for fathers, that Lord, that you would surround them with some men that would help them to add to their children's lives, whether girls or boys, it doesn't matter. They need a man to help put something in them. I pray that, Lord, you'll send them the right men that won't abuse, misuse, or inappropriately help those women. I pray in Jesus' name that the men that I'm talking to right now would understand their responsibilities, that they are to provide for their families. And it may not be like someone else, but they're to do their best. That these men, Lord God, would realize that they are to speak the truth in love and not lie and not to cover up, but to expose, Lord, the enemy and his lies. I pray that these men, God, would recognize their responsibility and never abandon their household. That, God, they would realize that you put them in this position because you know they have what it takes to fulfill their destiny. I pray in Jesus' name for all men everywhere, those in prison, Lord, those in war, those, Lord God, estranged from their children, those, Lord God, that feel like there's no hope. Give them, Lord God, a second chance. Give them, Lord, the opportunity to be back with their families, to pick up the fragments wherever they can, and to go from here. Develop them to be good men, good fathers. And Lord, we'll honor you and we'll give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, as the singers say. Praise God. Let's just thank God for what he's doing and how he's done it and what he's given us and how he's ministered to us in this session and allowing us on this Father's Day to recognize who he is and our responsibilities. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for everything that you're doing. We thank God for all of you that have been with us on this Sunday and on this Father's Day. If you take the time to encourage a father to go and to tell a man or a young man or even a grandfather or just some man that can step in the life of a young person and encourage them to be a good man, to be a good father, to help out where they can. We just thank God for you to be here, for you being with us here today. And we ask that God's blessing would be on you. And I just want to talk to the man, the woman, the young person that may be watching for the very first time, or maybe you've been with us a while, but yet you have not yet made a commitment to Jesus Christ. What do I mean by that? I mean that you realize that Jesus Christ is the one that came to this earth for you and that he died on a cross just for you and that he was buried in a grave. And then on the third day, he rose from the grave, rose from the dead, and is seated on the right hand of power and authority just for you. And if you believe that and you embrace that and you take that in, that God would want you to repent of your sins. What does that mean? That you just ask him to forgive you, that you recognize that you're a sinner. What sin are you talking about? The sin that you were born into, the sin that all of us were born into. It's that sin, the sin of Adam, that he's want you to recognize and ask forgiveness for. And when you ask God to forgive you of the sin that you were born into, he forgives you if you're serious and you embrace Jesus Christ as your Savior. Man, that's some of you are doing that right now. And as you do that, when you're finished, you need to look around you. Maybe there's a man or woman or young person that's a Christian, a believer in Jesus Christ that's with you right now, or maybe a friend or a relative or a neighbor that you go talk to who's a believer in Jesus Christ. You need to seek them out and say, I need you to baptize me in the name of Jesus for the remission of my sin. And they'll take you to a baptismal pool, maybe to a body of water, to a lake, or to a pool in somebody's backyard, and they will baptize you in Jesus' name. And when they bring you out of that water, the scripture says you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is to you and to your children and to as many as the Lord our God shall call, anyone who's willing to receive it. And you'll know that you've gotten it because you'll begin to speak in a language which you've never learned. We call it speaking in tongues. God bless you. We're so good, glad that you've decided to be part of this family. If you want to know more about Lighthouse of the Valley and myself even, just go to lighthouseofthevalley.org. There's a plethora of information for there for you, your family, your friends, everyone. We're just so glad that God has blessed you to be with us, and we're welcoming you not only to our family, but to God's family. God bless everyone. Greet each other all around you. You can worship all you want. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Amen.